Hut, look at that line. Look how many people showed up for Bianca Rose's poetry performance tonight. Ain't no way we standing in that line, honey. We both got our hats on. Ain't no way we'd even make it in the door. Hey, Persia, you know a good plumber? Hey, Huck, remember that time that you locked so-and-so up in the brig? We never get in. Hey, let's go around back and see if Jerry will let us in the back door. Yeah, let's do that instead. Oh, I'm so proud of my apprentice. Did you bring her gifts for after the show? Yeah, we gonna surprise her tonight. Yeah, that's gonna be good. She ain't expecting it. Yeah, we gonna have a full house tonight. Yeah, Kanji said the party stuff is all ready. She don't know that she's graduating tonight. It's my storytelling apprentice. She's been working with me for 2 years now. Yeah, 2 years straight. She can't tell a story by now, honey. You know, she's gotten so much better. Yeah, she has. She's gotten so much better. Took a licking and kept on ticking. She just kept practicing no matter what happened. They say, you know, a true artist, no matter what's going on in their life, the art never stops. You know, she done breaking chains and punching through boundaries and whatnot with her story writing, and just the storytelling part of it was the last beat, I suspect. She getting her confidence back, and, you know, part of that we can't help her with, you know. Hey, Jerry, how you doing, buddy? Hey, will you, yeah, it's Persian Hut. Yeah, will you let us up the back, please, sweetheart? I really appreciate it. Normally, we wouldn't try to, you know, sneak on in the back, but you saw that crowd out there. Yeah, Bianca got us box seats up at the top anyway. Yes, sir. Yeah, this'll let us out right in our little box. We got a good view. Hey, tell your wife I asked about her, brother. All right, thank you. Yeah, Jerry been out there. How long Jerry been working? At the World Tree Library. It was nice of him to let us up. He didn't have to. Ooh, my goodness, I forgot. These stairs is something else. Honey, you know, when did Dr. Miles say that you could take your stitches out from the black? I don't mind you signing entry, people. But I know you sort of, there are things you want to say that you got on your mind sometimes that you got to talk to people. How long did he say you got to keep your stitches in? Okay, well that's not too bad. Just a few more weeks then. Must be kind of nice having some time off being captain. Yeah. Yeah, I'm so proud of you. Yes, I know you don't like doctors. Oh, look, here we are. Yeah, okay, this is a perfect view. Is there a way we can sneak down backstage when she gets close to the end so we can give her presents and tell her she graduated in front of everybody? They don't got no naming day ceremonies in our people country. I think we should figure out how to give her one anyway when she's done being my stewardship apprentice, but in, you know, as far as storytelling apprentice, you know, sort of last minute, I just think she's really going to say so, because she, you know, doing some other things up in Clay People Country. She's going to have to tell stories pretty soon, and that'll help her confidence soon. Is there a way to get backstage after these? Okay, cool. Ooh, concessions. Ooh. Can you give us some nom-noms, honey, if I give you some calories? I would like the grease, and I would like some popcorn, please. Yes. Whose band she got? Oh, kids, I really like these guys. These are awesome. We'll be right back. DRRTY BĒ, you thank you, Jason Tarantino, who they just wrapped up here. Yeah, here she comes. Look, here she is. She doing poetry tonight. I'm so nervous for her. It's like I'm up there reading something myself for the first time. She never performed for this before. Oh my goodness, oh my word. So howdy here, bro. Oh man, I could hear a gang saying that when I got stitches in, Bianca. We see you, honey. We see you. Go get them, girl. Go get them. Okay. I'll be quiet. I'm just so nervous and excited for her.
Endangered citizen, I write to you today because I was not born a bird. Not so lucky as the dodo or the Carolina parakeet, which died in the same cage as the passenger pigeon. I have no hollow bones, no feathers, nothing so worthy of remembering as something that spreads its wings as easily as it breathes. I have no tusks, no mandibles, no antlers, no gills, no rare hide to speak of. Even the common termite or housefly makes itself more useful than I in the ordination of living things. And yet, here I am, held captive in someone else's version of the promised land, wanting the world to think of me the way they will one day remember what happened to the honeybee, the koala, the river dolphin, or black rhino. The only difference between us, me and whatever species of hawk or leopard or turtle or ape or whale, whatever climbs or claws or wings its way through this world, that we're determined to save by putting its picture on a postage stamp. Whatever it is we search for in the wild today to rebuild a habitat to stop poachers from killing too many, to ensure there's plenty of everything they need to survive into next year. People rarely search for me. They look for what I do, but they do not look for me. If they had, they'd know where I was the entire time. Right next to them. Adrift and drowning. Leda to the neighbor's girl. He won't come at all the way you might expect, wearing formal dress, blinding you with desire. You won't even recognize him when you're barefoot in your garden tending to the rosemary and he falls, dazzling as quartz from a low-hanging cloud. It'll be a simple thing, a flurry of feathers appearing to collapse in your arms. You won't even have to think twice about wrapping your limbs around his. Yours, like mine, bleeds. You think you'll be able to save him, and you'll try. He'll descend, white hot at first, sudden, falling the way accidental candle wax or an incense ember flares when it meets the skin. Before, I'd never given much thought to swans or any winged thing that wasn't born of paradise. To me, even a serpent contains more sentience behind its eyes or at least intent when it's set to strike. And yet, there will be something of the god about him, some small, stunning property left over from solar system formation even he won't be able to disguise. By the end, when he promises to deliver your young himself from their golden eggs, to hang a constellation especially for the girl child who favors him, you won't care. You won't remember your husband. You won't remember your name. All you'll know or will ever be content to know is the soft musk of covert feathers, the trembling prism of dusk, the ever-widening concave, the trumpet, The Ascent. The view from down here. A man I loved once told me how he believed in all the stories of people, whole civilizations much older than ours, living somewhere in a place he just called outer space. He used to claim that he was a born visionary, how much every man born ahead of his time needed only one woman to believe in the stories too. One time, he took me to the field behind his home, out past the creek, where alligators sometimes found themselves lost, past the pines and gargantuan azalea bushes, and the trail where we could walk were we so inclined. At night, the swimming hole in the middle of that field was not a swimming hole at all, but the entire Milky Way, crammed to the gills with stars, which, like the gators, sometimes lost their way. We floated, naked on our backs together, holding hands in the midnight water that was no longer water, but a spiral arm galaxy, and above us flew owls singing their hunting songs. We couldn't tell anymore what was earth and what was sky. We just knew we were part of it. And we looked for lights that moved too fast to be of this world. And when he fell silent, and I wondered aloud why I was there at all, he said he could use a witness, just in case someone showed up, not from around here, and they wanted to take him. He thought maybe someone else might want to come along, somebody who knows something of this world, who'd remind him of home. "Remember Earth?" he said, his eyes steeped in the lavender of lost stars, as he contemplated a future we would never know. "Man, I miss everybody." Creation myth. We brought them with us, the stars, and we got here first. We were navigators, looking to settle somewhere that reminded us of home. We were homesick. That's all. That's why we decided to stop. That's why we stayed. Don't listen when they tell you that, like them, we slopped our way ashore, dawdled our way from amoebas to apes, shedding vestigial limbs along the way, all mud-colored and oblivious without the gift of fire. We were already fully formed and cognizant of rainbows, had sought out and located the throbbing pulse of the cosmos in our own souls before we landed, and we sowed all that was left of our home stars into the seas and into the cliffs and into the plains. After all, it was a fixer-upper. But it had good bones. Just needed a little TLC. We stopped now and then to look around before squeezing storms from clouds and dew from crops. It's no mystery we had already sung the algorithms of a planet before they could even speak, had already forgotten the middle names of asteroids before they even thought to look up. Celestial bodies, we were and will always remain aware that no matter where we go in the universe, we are already in space. You're asking because you don't want to make the same mistake. It started with the one time we went to an amusement park. We decided to ride only the fastest, cruelest roller coasters, and in between we bought airbrushed hats and ate so much junk food because we were celebrating me moving home. We saved the most cantankerous roller coaster for last, and as we boarded, he said, "I'm not going to scream. I said, then what's the point of getting on? He said, I just want to see. And I said, well, I'm still screaming. And he did, and I did. For a long time, I kept the photo. The one they take on the last descent to catch you and several strangers become something like family in that 78 miles per hour second you almost fear for your life. And then, still wobbly-legged and insane, you buy it for 20 bucks as evidence of what you've survived with someone. I used to take it out and look at it when I needed to remember there'd been a first time he'd sat next to me, silent, while I screamed for both of us, ashamed I couldn't keep my mouth of vice, and smiling. To the woman I saw today who wept in her car. Woman, I get it. We are strangers. But I know the heart is a hive, and someone has knocked yours from its high branch in your chest, and it lays cracked and splayed, spilling honey all over the ground floor of your gut, and the bees inside that you've trained over the days and years to stay put swarm the terrain of your organs. Yes, right here in traffic while we wait for the light to change. I get it. How this array of metal and plastic tends to go woom woom once the door shuts, and maybe you were singing only moments before you got the call, or remembered that thing you had tucked back and built such sturdy scaffolding all around, and now here it comes to knock you adrift with only your steering wheel to hold you up. Or maybe today was just a tough day. And the sunlight and warm weather and blossoming limbs and smiling pedestrians waiting for their turn to cross are much too much to take when you think of all that's left in this day. And here you are, a reed, stuck in the mud of a rush hour intersection with so very many hours left to go. Woman, I know you. I know how that thing, when left unattended, will show up as a typhoon on your front door, demanding to be let in, or it will take the whole damn house with it. I know this place too. I get it. And because we are strangers, because you did not see me see you, my gaze had no more effect than a specter who stares at the living. And yet, I want you to know that today, in the hive of my heart, there is room enough for you. Black Mermaid, a bop. There are days I can't say whether I am real or I've made myself up. Am I a memory? Am I a dream? Surely this is me scrying for myself in the scrim surface of an enchanted lake. Or am I the moonlit rippling woman who always looks back? My God, I'm breathing underwater. Once I followed my children across an entire ocean when they were swallowed by a monstrous wooden whale. When I could go no further, I swam their dreams instead, showed them star maps so they would know the way back from anywhere, overcome by the salt and water in us all. They would need to learn my voice, see my face in their own reflections, and hear it in their tongues. What whale could possibly stomach a vastness such as this? My God, I'm breathing underwater. Sometimes I believe myself too good to be true. Pisces looms in my midheaven. I am the azimuth between water and wind. I am the wheelfish sucking on her own tail. I am story bearer to Yemoya, Mamiwata, Oshun, and Erzuli. Lest you forget, I am not a simple woman. My God, I'm breathing underwater. How Dolly Parton made Stephen Colbert cry on national TV by singing.
I understand that your mom used to teach you songs that tell stories, like old-fashioned songs. Do you remember any of the ones that your mom would sing with you?
I remember all of them. I remember Mama used to sing all those old songs brought over from the old world. But Mama was a good singer too, and she would just sing a cappella all the time. And so many of those songs were sad, and as I say, some of them just plumb pitiful. But I remember many songs. There was a song she used to sing called "Bury Me Beneath the Willow." It was about a girl that was going to get married, and her boyfriend left her at the altar, whatever. So she died, of course. She killed herself, I suppose. So bury me beneath the willow, under the weeping willow tree, where he may know where I am sleeping, and perhaps he'll weep for me. So anyway, there's more to it, but anyway, it was about her thinking today was our wedding day, but where can he be? He's gone to seek him another bride. He cares no more for me. And then bury me.
Because he wanted to, I guess. Because there's a part of him, like the rest of us, that he wakes up to every morning, wonders, how do I keep this lit? And then he gets up and goes on about the rest of his day, that question unanswered, forgets all about it, until someone comes through with a whole grain voice to breathe on it a little, as if to say, here, let me try. It's not just that it's been a hard year. There's always a lot riding on the shoulders of a man who has to make it up in his mind every day to not hurt anybody if he can help it. And that's the part he keeps mostly quiet, because he can't afford to get distracted, because he knows who and what he's fighting for. Can't afford to let anyone see what's been chipping away at the brick by brick in him all this time. Not when someone is depending on him, not when they sleep better knowing they're next to him or down the hall, or they know for a fact that when he's the one to pick up the phone, he's going to say come home, or that he's on his way. Or maybe he doesn't need to say much of anything. Just be the one to answer. And that's the part of any man worth singing to, about willow trees and what's buried beneath that isn't just root or seed. It's the part of him that asks a question when he wakes up each morning that rarely gets answered. But what he's wanting to know in the asking is that if he were to knock, would someone open up? Would they let him in and say, it's not too late? You still have time to get it right. And then keep on singing.
Beneath the willow, under the weeping willow tree, where he may know where I am sleeping, and perhaps he'll weep for me. So I better hush before he cries after death and we can't finish the show.
I'm like a lot of Americans, I'm under a lot of stress right now, Dolly.
And, I know you're not really.
You got
crying,
under my tripwire right there, I'll tell you right there. That was pretty beautiful.
We used to cry when Mama would sing, though. Mama would cry and we'd cry. And those old songs were just amazing, though.
The Secret to Eternal Youth. Fall in love. Often as possible. Stay with someone until you've heard all their stories. Then fall in love again and make new stories with them or another. No matter, the heart is a muscle. It wants exercise. Each little tear can only make room for more. It does not matter who or how many or how often you love, just that you do. There is no time in love. What is an hour? What is a year? What is 100 years? Love does not know these names. Love is only constructed of love. How else might one see what they are capable of? How vast and how limitless a being, unless one's love is reckless and careless and given freely without fear. Love like a child. There is no shame in love, and there is no shape to it. It fills whatever vessel can hold it, an ark as easily as a thimble. The thing itself does not change. In love, there are no soulmates. There are no husbands, no wives, no children, no siblings, no friends. There is only love, and we are all on its path, companions. On this path, there is no such thing as who loves more than whom. One person's love is not more efficient than another's. There is no piety here, no conditions, no calculations to resolve. After all, what is the unit with which you would measure all of your tears, all of your sighs of pleasure or despair? How much does your sleeplessness weigh? And what of happiness? How tall is your contentment? How deep is your surrender? What is the circumference of how much love has changed you each and every time? Then what happens when you find yourself at the bottom of love where you think you have excavated every acre of your abandon? What else, you might say, is there possibly left to know or perceive that I have not done already? This is where you must plant yourself in that space of unknowing and wait until you recognize in everyone that you have loved, in everything you have ever looked for in another, that the extended hand holding a hand, holding a hand, holding a hand, holding a hand, holding, 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 is your own. The woman is round. The woman is round the way he likes. And her hair is the aurora borealis. And her teeth are phantoms in selenite. And her clavicle is a tomb in which he thinks he would like to enshroud his lips. And her garment is a forsythia bush in spring, slipping from her right shoulder. So when she turns to look back at him, he can make out the birthmark on her back, which is a memento cumulus cloud adrift. And her spine is a hanked blue bottle dangling from a limb, and her gaze is the New Testament. And her left temple is a grove of pear trees, and the scar above her upper lip is a pier where she docks 1111 wishes, and her beauty mark is a mantis trapped in amber, and her ears are hyacinth blooms, and the tops of her breasts are waves cresting at dusk. And her knuckles are hard candy, and her scent is that of a newborn fawn or the underside of a pawpaw tree leaf. And her dreams are jelly jars crammed with stag beetles and butterfly wings and opossum bones and upper rooms, but he finds he can't ever touch her. His fingers slide off her skin, which is a crazy quilt of rainbow light spun from prisms. No matter how tightly he closes his fist. Legend of the Anima Mundi. When women were birds and soared above lolling hills and pines and snowdrifts, they sang of nothing but wingtips and bright plumes of wind carrying them high up to the rungs of clouds. When women were wolves and roamed across woodland floors and open fields and in the rain, they howled of nothing but earth scent and the heat of a sister's body running fast like river current alongside their own. When women were whales and floated through ocean and sea and mist, they hummed of nothing but kelp forests and the bright eyes of strange scaled beasts that illuminated the dark. When women were trees and grew tall in groves and in swamps and on mountainsides, they bloomed of nothing but the tongues of thunder, knew by heartwood the pulse of a planet. When women became women and strode on two strong ankles and carried babies in their bellies and buried loves and wept with joy and clapped or held hands and took turns carrying the sky, they told stories to themselves about before. When women had flown and ran and swam and stood straight through storms, their bones hollow or marrow-filled or overrun with hot sap and seed or cooled by deep descent. They remembered when they bent and changed and became new again and again and again, but they did not ever break. Legend of the Baobab Girl. Here is a girl who cannot get enough of everything. She crams everything she cannot get enough of into her mouth. She figures you can never know a thing completely unless you swallow it. Fireflies, they taste like prism light. When she shouts, they burst into fireworks down her throat. Marigold seeds taste like dawn an hour before it begins. A field grows where her stomach used to be. Family portraits, they are dream catchers. They dangle from her teeth. This girl could get used to the world living in her center like a hymn. If she stands still, everything she will never get enough of eventually has to pass her and pass through her, so she stops moving. She opens her mouth and leaves it that way. Her skin hardens. People climb up to hang bottles in her hair. They pour decanters of fire water at her feet until her legs believe they are arms and her arms believe they are towers of timber. And then comes the ground. In comes the sky, and she lives until she is a pillar, ancient and broad, until her feet are altars, while her hands are rafters, and she has caught every single daydream from every single wayward breeze on her tongue, and whistles them all into petticoat clouds lining the horizon's skirt, and everything, everything she reaches for, reaches back. Peace.